North Street and the Keighley Mechanics Institute, its tower still minus the clock, presented by Prince Smiths in 1892. Houses with gardens still occupy the left-hand side, wooden shops the right-hand side. The Mechanics Institute, with the clock tower installed, it was officially started on the 30th of June 1892. The clock was donated by Mr. Prince Smith in his memory of his father. The Keighley Cooperative Electric Tramways were formally inspected by the Board of Trade officials on Wednesday, October the 12th, 1904, and all being found satisfactory, the cars commenced running at 4:30 the same afternoon. In the course of 6 hours service, 3,600 passengers were carried. The War Memorial was unveiled in 1924. The Town Hall Square was a popular place where lots of shrubs were planted. On the right can be seen the Cavendish Street United Free Church, better known as the Cock Chapel, with its weathercock which crowed 125 feet above the street, on top of the highest spire in Keighley. Closed for worship in 1937, this chapel was to enjoy a new lease of life as headquarters for the Keighley Squadron of the Air Cadet Corps before being demolished in 1951. The site is now being occupied by Keighley College. The Mechanics Institute clock tower looks stately from all angles. Here, about 1905, it completes the vista down Highfield Lane and Albert Street. In the left foreground is the Albert Street Baptist Chapel, erected in 1865 in the Byzantine style. Beyond, the Temperance Institute of 1896. This important social centre comprised of a large hall seating 800, a lower hall for 350, and a variety of small rooms. In the 1930s, the building was accommodating at least 1,800 meetings a year. On the right are the public baths, which had originated in 1866 after a 7-year controversy, which had split ratepayers into two camps, Bathites and anti-Bathites. The Mechanics Institute was gutted by fire on the 3rd of March 1962. The building was used for the town's most important civic and social functions, and these had to be transferred to Victoria Hall. The shell of the burnt out hall remained for another 5 years before it was replaced with an extension to the Technical College. Flames shot 300 feet into the sky as 75 firemen battled the blaze in vain. It was a startling contrast, the bitter cold froze water from the hoses, yet a shop window on the opposite side of North Street cracked with the fierce heat. It is 25 minutes to one on a June day in 1899, at the junction of North Street and Cavendish Street, and only the clip-clop of a heavily laden horse tram disturbed the afternoon calm. The Corporation Stone Yard occupied the site of the future Town Hall Square. Crowds watching the elephants and camels of Sanger's Circus parading through the drizzle along North Street in March 1902. There was a smallpox epidemic in the north of England at that time, and Keighley's medical officer of health had visited Sanger's Circus at Cone the day before to check that none of the employees showed signs of infection. The spire seen here belongs to the United Methodist Free Church. This denomination had originally succeeded from the Wesleyans during a dispute over an organ. It opened in 1868 and was nicknamed the Cock Chapel in honour of its weathercock, which crowed 125 feet above the street, on top of the highest spire in Keighley. The war memorial was erected in 1924 and unveiled in December the same year, in front of a gathering of no less than 25,000 people, over half the town's population. In excess of £6,000 had been raised by public subscription to pay for the bronze statue, Peace Victory, which features a wreath in one hand and a branch in the other, and standing 35 feet above the neatly laid out square below. During the Great War, over 900 Keighley men gave their lives, so it is not surprising that the unveiling received so much support. Riley Stationers, on the corner of Lorcombe Crescent and Cavendish Street, with the area at the back being cleared for redevelopment. On the opposite corner can be seen the Halifax Building Society, dated between 1961 and 1965. An imposing view of one of Keighley's all-time favourites, entertainment venues, opened in 1900 as the Queen's Theatre. It was renamed the Hippodrome less than a decade later. The theatre was known by both names by local people throughout its 60 years life. Over the years, top names in musical hall entertainment appeared here. Gracie Fields, Tommy Handley and George Formby, to name but a few. The Hippodrome Theatre interior in 1956. This magnificent building seated 429 in the stalls, 257 in the circle and 400 in the gallery. There were three public bars and the artists had the use of seven dressing rooms. Fleece Mills, a town centre industrial complex seen here about 1905, behind the less fashionable side of Cavendish Street. The original Fleece Mills was built by William Sugden about 1819 and shortly afterwards became the first factory in Keighley to be lit with gas. Some of the single-storey businesses in the foreground are trading on their addresses. There is Cavendish hosiery and boot and leather merchant Albert Massey, patented canvas felt socks for keeping the feet warm in winter. This is the spacious view up Cavendish Street, which by the early 1900s was intended to impress the visitor emerging from Keighley Railway Station. On the left, the Victoria Hotel catered primarily for commercial travellers. Its novelties included a hydraulic lift, electric lights, most artistically arranged, and a grand restaurant and buffet. It could also lay on balls and public banquets. On the right, pedestrians are protected by a stylish glass canopy. 36 of these handsome shops have been built by Sir Prince Smith, textile manufacturer and director of the Bradford District Bank. The old railway station was behind the shops in Cavendish Street. The station was built in 1846. And at the beginning of the 1880s, it was recognised that better accommodation was required and that the ruinous structure must be replaced. When the line from Thornton to Keighley was built, the new railway station opened on the other side of Bradford Road in 1883 and the old station was demolished. The fifth home of Keighley Post Office in North Street. Impressed by the increased businesses which James Cook, the postmaster, had created, the authorities decided to move the post office to larger premises when he retired in 1877. It stayed there until September 1891, when it was transferred to Townfield Gate. Keighley Bus Station in 1955. When there were still factories and chimneys in the centre of town. This is when the bus stops used to be round the Town Hall Square. You can see the burnt out mechanics in the background and the new technical college on the right hand side. An interesting view of the bus station site as it was during the reconstruction. The date was 1970 and new facilities were being built on the same side as the existing station. Keighley's Horse and Cattle Fair, traditionally held in May and November, were the occasion for general holiday and entertainment. These cows stand for sale in Russell Street in about 1905, when increased traffic had pushed business off the main thoroughfare. Afterwards, the fire brigade would hose the streets. The King's Arms, seen here on Church Green, has a very long history and was once an old coaching inn, complete with stables and barns. More recently, it was the headquarters for the Keighley Rugby League Football Club in the early years of the club's development. Players would change their clothes at the King's Arms before departing for the match. The match referee would also change there before taking a cab to the ground. Sadly, the King's Arms place in history was pulled down during redevelopment. Here we see shops on Cook Lane. Rhodes and Padgett's Ironmongers on the left. Next we have J.W. Wilson and Sons, confectioners. Then A. Midgley's. In the next block we have the gas office and showroom. Then the direct walk round store and the Stylo shoe shop on the right hand corner. A view at the end of Cook Lane with Ramsbottom's Electrical on the right hand side and the Central Milk Bar on the left hand side. Cook Lane showing the Conservative Club, the Salvation Army Citadel and the bonding warehouse of E&T Wall, shortly before they were demolished in 1961 to make way for the new shopping centre. Since 1897, the warehouse casks of wine came from the Mediterranean, but because it was stored under bond, it could not be visited without a customs official being present. The gas showrooms, Cook Lane, which were opened on the 6th of May 1902. Initially, gas was produced in 1825 for the purpose of street lighting, and not until this was accomplished were the improvement commissioners allowed to sell gas to the general public. The first gas works were at Low Bridge but moved to Thwaites in 1876. Cook Lane. From the left to right we have the bonding warehouse where wines and spirits were stored. Next we have Bruce Johnson's toy shop combined with Urich's photographic shop. Then we have Thomas Hobson's ladies shop and on the right Keighley Health Store. April 1966, a handful of shoppers going about their business on Cook Lane. Cook Lane is famous for where Timothy Taylor started his famous brewing business a century and a half ago in 1858. By 1863, Taylor's brewing activity relocated to Knoll Springs, a move made necessary by constantly increasing demands for his beer. Ramsbottom's was a well-known name in the field of television rental and record sales in Keighley. Their business on Cook Lane is featured in this photograph. A thought-provoking scene showing Cook Lane and the direct walk-round store. The power of advertising was graphically demonstrated in July 1969 when notices proclaiming this closing down sale appeared in the local press and caused a queue of bargain hunters nearly 200 yards long. Further along the street, the Northeastern Gas Board was also having a sale, though it seemed less popular than the one being held at the shop next door. The closure of the two businesses was caused by the impending town centre redevelopment. The closure of the cinemas began in March 1957, when the Cosy Corner, an affectionately regarded flea pit for 45 years, announced its last performance. Owner Alan Jude quietly declared the Cosy's demise was accelerated by television. Nostalgic film fans paid a sad farewell to the Cosy during the last film called Coming Round the Mountain. Seat prices at the end were still only 10 pence and 1 shilling. The Cosy has long since disappeared under town centre redevelopment. About 1930, this little newsagent and stationer's shop with a bow window in Changegate, the old name by which the top of end of Low Street was known into the present century. There was a Thomas Crabtree selling books in Changegate in the 1830s. He supplied the Mechanics Institute library in its earlier years. Whilst the firm printed hundreds of posters during the middle decades of the 19th century, in common with so much old property, Crabtree succumbed to Between the Wars redevelopment. Union Infirmary, better known as St John's, Fell Lane, Keighley. The Keighley Guardians purchased land in 1868 to build the workhouse infirmary with fewer wards in case of cholera and other epidemics. In 1917, it provided beds for the war wounded until it closed in February 1919. It reopened to cater for geriatric patients and also had a maternity unit. It closed in August 1970 when the last of its patients were transferred to Airedale Hospital. Fell Lane is typical of much of Keighley's Victorian suburb housing. The population rose from 21,859 in 1861 to 41,564 in 1901. Many of the houses in the area were built by the Keighley Industrial Cooperative Society, whose enterprises in the 1890s included stores, a farm, newsrooms, a restaurant and a pork pie bakery. Postcards like this were produced in large numbers by small shopkeepers. Amos Dewhurst had started up as a newsagent, stationer and tobacconist in 1899 in nearby Oakworth Road. A keen photographer, he developed a sideline in local views. Described at the time of its demolition in 1934 as the most picturesque survival of 18th century Keighley, the Fleece Hotel made way for a Marks and Spencer's store. During the 1820s, it has served as a meeting place for a woolcombers club in early form of trade union, and a stagecoach travellers had set out from the Fleece aboard the Royal Alexandra for Leeds, the Tradesman for Bradford and the Wonder for Halifax. One of the Fleece's interior doors was found to have had at different times no less than 8 keyholes. Gotton Butterfield's hardware shop in the Royal Arcade, Low Street, which closed in 1983. This was a shop in the old tradition which appeared to sell everything, and if they did not stock what you required, they could always get it for you. William Gott started his business in 1890, taking Frank Butterfield into partnership with him in 1910. In 1305, Edward I granted Keighley's market charter to Henry de Keighley, whose family remained lords of the manor for 15 generations until a 16th century daughter of the last male of the line married a Cavendish of the Dukes of Devonshire. For more than 500 years, the market was held on Church Green, but moved into this purpose-built site in 1833 and occupying it until 1971. The market still holds an important place in working class memories. Most veterans recall late Saturday night shopping excursions when perishable goods, foodstuffs, were sold off cheap. This is the view along Market Street towards Low Street. The heavily loaded pole above the rooftops marks the old telephone exchange. Here are some more views of Keighley's old market. And here we can see Gilbert Wilson's, who used to be one of the best fish sellers in Keighley, as can be seen by the queue. The drafty but much loved market area pictured shortly before it was demolished. Crowds flocked to see the opening of the new market in June 1971 by the Mayor Alderman Sidney Bancroft. The sixth home of Keighley Post Office at Townfield Gate. It was opened by Mrs. James Cook on the 21st of September 1891. The building is now part of the council offices and the post office is now in the shopping centre. Across to the left can be seen Bruce Johnson's toy shop with Urich's camera shop. This photograph was taken in 1946. The smallest house in Keighley, photographed at Damside in 1924. It's simply a basement and a flight of half a dozen well-worn steps up to a single tiny room, heated by a fire with a tall chimney stack, squashed between normal buildings. In the basement, a dyer had once worked two vats. This is the passageway which ran down the side of the parish church, leading to Keighley Market. The buildings on the left are now a car park. St Andrew's National School at the bottom of West Lane was Church of England. It opened in 1834 with accommodation for about 1,274 pupils. Horses used to be left in the playground when the cattle fairs were on in Russell Street. The school closed in about 1990 and came up for sale on the 6th of March 1992. Demolition work started on the old school on the 24th of April 1992. One of Keighley's many lost public houses, the Ship Inn, at the bottom of West Lane. It was demolished in 1969 after owners Bentley's Yorkshire Breweries Limited proposed to let its lease lapse. Its frontage by then had to be shored up by timber. Here we see two views of the Yorkshire Bank, which used to be on North Street. There were steps up to it and there were shops underneath. Low Street, about 1910. Low Street is one of the oldest streets in Keighley. The shop in the centre at the back is Henry's General Emporium, who sold most everything. One of the things they sold was invalid whiskey, which was a favourite medicine for teetotalers. A view looking up Low Street. Notice the three-wheeler Scammel coming in on the right-hand side. A busy shopping scene in Low Street, recorded in September 1961. No wonder it was busy, because at that time Low Street was one of the main shopping areas in Keighley, as evidence of the Marks & Spencer store in the centre. This branch of Britain's best loved retailer was opened initially in 1912, but it was extensively modernised and reopened in the form seen here in March 1935. Further extensions took place in July 1969. The influence of a Marks & Spencer store in any town cannot be underestimated. Many retail specialists consider the location of the M&S to be the very centre of the shopping activity in a town, and prospective tenants or owners of retail property in relation to M&S value their property with it. The power of to attract customers has been finally turned over the decades. the Cross and Low Street. On the left we can see Uncle Chadwick's, dated about 1950. Uncle was a nickname for pawnbrokers. The front of the shop was a gentleman's outfitter's and the back of the shop was a pawn shop. In 1876, a small cottage hospital was opened on the Highfield side of Keighley in a house rented for £75 a year. It had 8 bedrooms and a matron with one young girl to help her. Patients could be expelled for using profound or abusive language and guilty of improper conduct, or using spirituous liquors whilst operations were performed on a formal kitchen table. In fact, this represented the start of a prestige hospital. The Toll House at the bottom of Bar Lane, Riddlesden. Tolls were last collected here in 1868, but it was a feature of Stockbridge for about 150 years. It was used as a grocer's shop for a period up to 1972, when it was demolished to improve safety on the road, as it was considered one of the danger spots in the Keighley area. This is Eastwood House in Victoria Park. It was once used as Keighley's museum. Keighley's most grandest residence, Cliff Castle, was built over a decade from 1875 by gentleman manufacturer Henry Isaac Butterfield. Described at the time as a modernised Tudor castle in the Victorian era, Cliff Castle supported a fine conservatory and winter gardens, a lamp post from the Thames embankment before its entrance porch, and such treasures as Rossini's bed and Chinese vases looted from the Chinese Emperor's summer palace in Peking. In 1950, Cliff Castle and its extensive grounds were bought and given to the town by Sir Bracewell Smith, a native of Keighley and former Lord Mayor of London. Keighley's gasworks at Thwaites opened in 1876. The town had been lit by gas since 1825. 50 years later, the growing population required a larger scale of operation. The new Thwaites site included a section of old river course utilised for tipping and adjoining the railway, from which elevated sidings led into the retort house and coal stores. The offices and laboratories boasted a decorated clock tower. There was also a dining room and baths for the workmen. After an official opening, the chairman of the local board entertained guests to dinner and menu of hare soup, turbot, calf's head, pigeon pie, pheasant and partridge. Meanwhile, the gas committee provided a supper for the whole employers of the gas department. This is the chimney that used to be from Wallace timber merchants. Notice the stone faces on it. Timmy Feather, outside his cottage at Buckley Green, Stanbury. He was born on the 20th of January 1825 and died on the 30th of November 1910. He was the last handloom weaver in Keighley, and his loom is preserved in Cliff Castle Museum as a record of a bygone age. August 1958, Mr. James Hardy and Mr. William Lund are seen here. They had refused to leave their single room dwelling in Damside when the property was being demolished. No one seems to know what happened to them. Michael MacDonald, or better known as Spud Mick, had been selling roast potatoes at the bottom of Cavendish Street for 50 years when this photograph was taken in 1929. Every week for half a century, said the Keighley News, the brightly polished brasswork had come out from its shed and thousands of cold hands have been warmed by the hot potatoes from Mick's engine. The notice on the drum of this one-man band reads, "I am an Italian subject and have lived in England 35 years, brought up a family of children, three of my children are now serving under British flag. Proofs shown if necessary. A. D'Ambros. There are no more jolly games like this basket stacking contest played by market traders who worked long hours but were able to relax during quieter spells. Keighley's old wooden stall market, demolished in 1971, served as a robust focal point of community. Here we see barrel rolling contests along Market Street. Here we can see Emily Matchbox, Between the Wars character, taken for a ride in Keighley Market with a spontaneous audience of tradesmen. Mrs. Harriet Shackleton had a stall which was made of old wooden boxes and piled her trade in Cook Lane. She sold vegetables and flowers until the mid-1960s and was one of the last street traders in Keighley. And it's all change. The hot point washing machine was the latest thing in 1928 kitchen technology. Taking the plunge. The old washboard and mangle was backbreaking work for thousands of Keighley women every Monday. Here we see one of the old drain cleaners that we used to have. And here we see another cleaner, which we used to see around our streets. We don't seem to see them these days. Here we see a three-wheeler Morgan Super Sports car, photographed at Spencer Street in 1946. These 1930s Hattersley's looms are about to be transported by this three-wheeled Scammel mechanical horse, a semi-trailer which had the advantage of turning in a 15-foot circle as compared with a 41-foot required by a conventional lorry of the same period. Gas-powered vehicles like the one seen here were used during war times when petrol was very scarce. Now just sit back and relax and enjoy a few photographs of some of Keighley's old transport. Thank you all for watching these views of Old Keighley. We hope you have enjoyed it.